season of IHRA drag racing began in Darlington, South Carolina, where machinery was pushed to the limit and beyond. It was open season on World Champions. Top Fuel King Doug Herbert, meet Rhonda Hartman. See you later, champ. In Pro Mod, Scotty Cannon smashed records, then lost in round one. It was the same for Billy Huff in Pro Stock, 0 for 1 in 95. In Funny Cars, Dennis Bedrosian came in with no wins and no chance against champion Mark Thomas. But Thomas blinked first in the final, and Bedrosian went home a winner. Now it's time for round two. Welcome to Sweet Home Alabama. Alabama International Dragway, there is the new queen of Top Fuel, Rhonda Hartman. And there is her opponent, her arch rival in one of the most celebrated incidents of the season in 1994, Pontiac Jack Ostrander.
These two had a severe disagreement last year at Morocco, Indiana. However, things have been patched up since then, and it was over this very thing, the staging procedure. Seems like Hartman likes to stage first, Ostrander likes to stage last, and she feels he takes just a little too long.
Pontiac Jack Ostrander, with an all-volunteer crew, will race anybody, anytime, anywhere. Hartman with the advantage off the line, side by side at half track.
Hartman has a problem. The blower belt breaks and goes away. Pontiac Jack, and he's got one bank down, but he pulls out the victory with a sensational 5:19. Now watch the blower belt on Hartman's car go right there, and that could have cost her the race.
Brett Kepner waits on the top end.
I don't think I need to tell Jack Ostrander just how important that single run was. After the failure to qualify at the Winter Nationals, to take out the points leader meant a lot.
It was a pretty good win, too. That's the first time we've got down this racetrack really good. It's a brand new car, and we were just, we couldn't even figure the thing out in Darlington, so it's pretty nice.
I should point out, I'm sure you felt it nose over a little bit. You both burned pistons, 519 to 526.
Oh, I'm sure.
There's Rhonda, what a battle.
Well, whether she hits him or not, our defending Super Nationals champion is on the trailer. Our next pair will match this man, Richard Langson, the 1993 world champion from Carson City, Nevada, against Rick Cray from Chagrin Falls, Ohio.
Rick Cray, relatively unknown on the IHRA circuit as of late, but the King Rat and that single wing is very well known. This man managed to get this car to qualify number two with some expert wrenching technique.
That man, of course, is Big Daddy Don Garlitz. So Rick Cray has his work cut out for him here, the number seven qualifier in this eight-car field.
You can bet Cray will probably take a shot on the tree. That's the only chance he's got to ET the Garlitz car.
Swamp Rat 34, very narrow profile and a red light before Cray ever moves.
Actually, Cray may not have been staged there. However, Langston paused, hesitated, and then said, oh, well, and drove it right on through.
6-2 with a 65 at 266 miles an hour for Richard Langston, who will move on to the semis. Now, here is Jim Bailey from Mantua, Ohio. A strong season last year. His opponent, Clayton Harris from Cullman, Alabama, the big local favorite. Harris, a pioneer in clutch technology in nitro racing.
Clayton Harris actually ran the IHRA very successfully back in the late 70s. He won the IHRA Top Fuel World Championship in 1978. Don't count this guy out.
Unsponsored blue machine on the left is Harris. On the right, Jim Bailey, who has made a very successful transition from alcohol funny cars. But right now, he has got Harris out in front of him.
Clayton Harris with a 520, 264 miles per hour, like the old New Dimension car. Watch this car get up on the tire on top end and take the win.
Here's a close look with our finish line camera. Half a car length. Ooh, Harris may have that clutch working, and that's bad news for everyone. Now here is the world champion with a big number one on the side, Doug Herbert from Cherryville, North Carolina. And his opponent will be the technically interesting four overhead cam machine, David Grubnik from Acton, California.
Doug Herbert's number one in more ways than just being the world champion. He also managed to qualify number one at this event. Has to be the odds-on favorite to win here.
Grubnik in the near lane, the number eight, the slowest qualifier in the field, so he may take a look at the tree too. And Doug Herbert is shown red lighting.
Unbelievable. Doug Herbert, probably one of the few times you'll see him redline in his entire career. The McGee engine moves into round number two for the first time ever.
So Jack Ostrander will meet David Grupnik in the semifinals of Top Fuel, while Clayton Harris takes on Richard Langston. We're underway. Of the International Hot Rod Association continues on a golden day in Steele, Alabama at the Super Nationals by Parts Pro. Hello again, everyone. I'm Bob Barsha. When Alabama International Dragway first joined the Snap-on Tools IHRA Trail in 1994, the reaction around the paddock was unanimous. Great racetrack. Lousy weather. You see, the Super Nationals were running a midsummer date, and the weather alternated between blistering sunshine and the traditional southern thunderstorms. But this year, the Super Nationals have been moved to a springtime date. And like the season-opening Winter Nationals in Darlington, South Carolina, the performance numbers have been eye-popping, and the human stories are even better. Standing by now with one of those is my ESPN broadcast colleague, Ted Jones.
The last time we saw this car, it was sitting in a cow pasture that's off the end of the shutdown at Darlington International Dragway. As a matter of fact, there was a fence post impaled through its injectors. This is the alcohol funny car of Dennis Bedrosian. Now, who is he and what did he do? Well, he came to the All-Pro Winter Nationals at Darlington, South Carolina. He set a new track record, came to within a hundredth of a second of setting a world record, won the event, took the IHRA Snap-on Tools points lead, and the end result is he's become Mark Thomas's worst nightmare. And as is the case with most IHRA drag racers, although they're intense competitors on the drag strip, they become the best of friends in the pit area. Also consider the fact that Mark Thomas is heavily financed with his ethanol's major sponsorship, whereas Bedrosian has a very modest budget. However, the bottom line is he is the points leader, and Mark Thomas has to respect that.
Now, don't let that heat haze fool you. We have beautiful conditions here at Steele, 69 degrees, low 41% humidity, and a nice light 12-mile-an-hour breeze out of the west. This ESPN Speed World presentation is brought to you by Quaker State, the intelligent oil for longer engine life. And by the more than 1,000 AutoZone stores across America. AutoZone, the best parts in auto parts. When we return to Alabama International Dragway, we'll have quarterfinal action in Pro Stock. Stay with us. Welcome back to Steele, Alabama, where preparations continue in the paddock. This has been a record-breaking weekend in the door slammer categories. With more, here's Brett Kepner.
1 year ago, this event was one of the quickest on the IHRA Tour in 100-degree heat. Well, everybody knows that Roy Hill's two-car Ford Thunderbird Pro Stock team is one of the most brutal in all of Pro Stock racing. But this weekend, they've become the premier two-car team in the sport. Let's face it, the Pro Stock class at the Winter Nationals was unbelievable, but this one defies description. 6.87 seconds just to qualify. Five Fords in the top four spots with the first four under 6.80 seconds, but this Mike Bell-driven Roy Hill Drag Racing School team car is now the quickest in the world at an unbelievable 6.73 seconds. We saw two cars over 205 miles per hour in the 16-car field, but this could be one of the roughest ones to win ever. I should point out that Pro Modified was no situation that was any different than Pro Stock. 6.50 second world record for Scotty Cannon of the Onset Magazine Machine, even a world record in alcohol funny car. The top fuel field was one of the toughest in IHRA history. All this adds up to a Super Nationals that could be one of the greatest drag races ever.
No question about it, Brett. Let's get right into that record-breaking Pro Stock category now. Our first matchup, an interesting north-south border clash. There is Robert Patrick Jr. You ride with him, as we will throughout the day. His car is sponsored by Ford Quality Care of the USA. His opponent, John Koenigshofer from Otterville, Ontario, Canada, a Thunderbird sponsored by Ford Quality Care of Canada. So you can bet there's some executives sitting around tapping their pencils right now.
Robert Patrick, the young lion, has had really quick reflexes off the starting line. He started last year, and this year he's getting even faster. Watch him off the line as he gets the hole shot with a 444.
Boy, I thought he was rolling there. You ride with him as he flashes through the lights, takes the win, 687 with a 6, 201 miles an hour.
As we view it again, this time from outside the car, you can see that hole shot front end off the ground for young Robert Patrick. He had it wire to wire. Actually, Koning Schofer is never really in it.
Easy to say as they're shoulder to shoulder there at half track, but this is the kind of competition we're used to. Watch this finish. Half a car length. On to our next pair. There is the sensation of the weekend thus far. John Yoke from Ellenboro, West Virginia. His opponent, Mark Thomas from Cincinnati, Ohio. Another Ford for Yoke, a Thunderbird against the Olds Cutlass of Thomas.
Now, Oldsmobile has stepped up with 813 cubic inches as the manufacturers continue to battle it out in the Mountain Motors. You know, there's no cubic inch limit on these engines. Ford dominated for a while with 810, then they went to 812. Now, Mark Thomas comes out with 813 inches.
John Yoke's car, sponsored by his dad's Ford dealership, barely out of his teens, a former sportsman competitor. And Yoke has been stomping the field all weekend long as he sets Thomas down.
Look at this, 684 for John Yoke and a nice 476 reaction time.
Now here is the guy that Brett Kepner was talking about earlier, Mike Bell. And here is a look at his record run on Saturday night.
Everybody was absolutely stunned. Never had Mike Bell gone this fast. Never had anyone in pro stock history gone a 673.
Jack Collins, the track owner and builder, has prepared this surface to perfection. Now there is Harold Denton from Middlesex, North Carolina, and his 94 Pontiac Firebird. He will take on Bell, who hails from Asheboro, North Carolina, in what else? A 95 Thunderbird.
You know, Bell has had a lot of respect for Denton. Talk about age and experience. Never count the old man out. Although Bell is off the line first, slightly ahead of him, he's going to pull out the victory with a 680 to a losing 682.
Harold Denton set down the world champion Billy Huff in the first round, but he obviously had problems on that pass. Our final matchup, here is Doug Kirk. Why is there not a sponsor on this car? He has been the sensation of the season thus far. His opponent right there, Carlton Phillips from Woodbridge, Virginia, a 95 Pontiac Firebird against a 95 Olds Cutlass.
Doug Kirk, who set the pace early down at Darlington, South Carolina, is not doing it with the big, big engine. He has 802 cubic inches of Sonny Leonard Oldsmobile, but it's as fast as anyone in the pack.
Just a few years ago, could we imagine ourselves saying 802 cubes is little?
High RPMs, you can listen as they come up against the stutter boxes. Kirk out on top now with a 682, 204 miles per hour to nose out Carlton.
Once again, it will be elapsed time that decides lane choice in the next round. Here's another look at the Kirk-Phillips matchup. Phillips actually got out first, but Kirk drove around him. With that pass, Doug Kirk will have lane choice in his semifinal matchup with John Yoke, while Mike Bell will have the choice of lanes when he meets Robert Patrick Jr. in an all-Ford matchup. Now the Pro Stocks head to the paddock. The Pro Mods are in the staging lanes. A big crowd on hand enjoying the weather and the action here at AID. Right now it's time for this week's edition of The Race Mechanic with Roy Hill and Ted Jones. Today we'll talk about what's going to happen when those Pro Stocks reach their cruise.
I'm in the Pro Stock pit area of Roy Hill, the race mechanic, here at the Parts Pro Super Nationals in Steele, Alabama. Roy has just completed a qualifying run, and his crew has to move plenty fast. You have to get ready for the next qualifying run, Roy. What are you going to do first?
You know, coming down the return road, thinking about what's happened on this run. The guys will take the hood off the car, the hood scoop, check the carburetors. I called in on the radio. I told them I felt a little flutter in high gear. I also felt some tire shake and a little clutch slippage. Tommy will take the computer reading out of the computer. We'll go inside the trailer and boom, everything I've told him I felt, we'll see on the screen. Maybe I'm not as sharp as I think I am sometimes, though.
This all happens in a matter of moments. That's the race mechanic for this week.
And it's going on right now. We'll move on to our next class, Pro Modifieds in the lanes. We'll be right back. Welcome back to Alabama International Dragway. Bob Varsha, Ted Jones, and Brett Kepner. Glad to have you with us for the Super Nationals by Parts Pro. We are ready for quarterfinal action in Pro Modified. Once upon a time, you wouldn't bring a nostalgia-bodied car to a race like this. Now, six of our eight quarterfinalists are in these fantastic nostalgia-bodied machines, including our first matchup, Chuck Peterson from South Dakota in his supercharged 70 Chevy Chevelle, and Steve Johnson from Illinois in a 57 Chevy Bel Air.
Also of special note, this is a supercharged car with 526 cubic inches against the big 706 cubic inch Pontiac nitrous injected 57 Chevrolet. What a race, not good enough. Chuck Peterson with a 663, a full tenth of a second, although Johnson gets him right off the starting line. You can see right here, he's out first.
He is out horsepower, no question about it. You can see the yellow car in the far lane of Peterson has the advantage. At half track, down to the line they come. Oh, he may have doubled it. Now here's one of only two contemporary bodied cars in the field. That was 200 mile an hour Bill Kuhlman. This is Pat Moore out of Ohio, racing for former NBA star Larry Nance of the Cleveland Cavaliers. It'll be a 68 Camaro against a 95 Corvette, and Kuhlman thinks there's a lot to come from this Moore machine.
Larry Nance now is out of pro basketball, ended in racing totally. Now that Larry's out, putting all of his attention in the car, he's one team to be reckoned with, along with about 25 others.
Well, now the moment of truth. Moore in the near lane, Kuhlman in the far lane. Once again, it is a nitrous-boosted car against the supercharged machine. This time, the blown machine got out first. Kuhlman with the advantage, but Moore drives around.
Lately, Larry Nance has had that car really humming. He manages to send Bill Kuhlman back to the trailer. Watch out, you're going to hear more from Pat Moore.
I guess Kuhlman was right. Now, here's an interesting pair. On the left, Tommy Mooney from Shelby, North Carolina. On the right, Carl Moyer from Ankeny, Iowa. And here is a look at what Tommy Mooney accomplished during the night of fire. Watch the left lane.
Tommy Mooney, a 6:57, the quickest nitrous-injected run ever in Pro Modified history.
And that will add fuel to the fire between proponents of the supercharged or the nitrous-boosted, normally aspirated drivetrains. There's a look at Mooney and Moyer. Carl Moyer is the defending Super Nationals champion. He is in the far lane, but it's a new car. He drove a Corvette last year. This is a 38 Chevy replica.
Moyer has really been humming with this Chevy, out of shape and has to shut it down. And what a great gate job by Moyer. He throws it away. Tommy Mooney cruises on almost a single to victory.
0.07 of a second, Carl Moyer had on Tommy Mooney. There you see it, but right there in the far lane, Moyer gets out of shape, heads for the center line, has to shut it down. Now our final matchup. There is Tommy Gray Jr. from Baltimore, Maryland, in his 94 Corvette. There is the man, the killer red tomato, Scotty Cannon. Here is his night of fire action.
Nobody could believe this. He cranked off a brand new world record, 6.50. Absolutely unbelievable.
I tell you, I'm never going to believe Scotty Cannon again when he tries to tell me how much is left in that car. He just goes quicker and quicker. Cannon, the four-time world champion, going up against Tommy Gray Jr., who's really got to make a run at the tree, I think, Ted.
He has no choice. Scotty Cannon cranking out 650s. You've got to take a shot on the tree, and he never got off the line. Scotty Cannon on another great run. Watch the ET on this one. 658, almost anticlimactic, Bob.
The only man in the 6.5s. That will easily give Scotty Cannon lane choice in his matchup with the improving Pat Moore. Tommy Mooney will have lane choice when he goes up against Chuck Peterson.
Jack Ostrander only made one qualifying run to even get into this program, and it was a fiery one. The brand new car burned up a lot of engine parts. In the first round of eliminations, you saw a lot of smoke at the finish line from the car, too, but here's the reason. This intake valve started burning up big time, and when this piston started melting in and collapsed and closed up the rings, it indeed killed the power to that cylinder. That's why Ostrander's machine fell off in performance. However, there's one other reason. The fact that there's not a single cloud in the sky here today at Alabama International Dragway is making the mid-range of the track starting to get a little soft. The rubber on the track is actually plowed, and they're spinning the tires, burning the centers out. Now, you have to remember, when the tire grows from centrifugal force, the only part that's on the track is that little area there, and it's spinning. Right now, they've replaced the pistons and valves. Looks like Ostrander is ready for his semi-final challenge.
Boy, but not without a lot of hard work. Thanks, Brett. We'll take a timeout, and when we come back, we'll go from door slammers to floppers. Alcohol Funny Car. Welcome back to Sweet Home Alabama International Dragway, where the recent unpleasantness is still referred to as the War of Southern Independence. We'll put a few gallons of methanol in the tank, crank up the blowers, and go alcohol funny car racing. That is Larry Dobbs from Welland, Ontario, and his countryman from Lyle, Ontario, Doug Hearsome.
You know, Dobbs has one of those mountain motor funny cars since the IHRA lifted the 526 cubic inch limit. He runs 541 inches of Arius power.
Both cars stage, great launch. Hearsome in the near lane with the advantage by a tenth of a second. Dobbs way over by the wall, but he takes him.
And with a 6.03, if that run would have been straight, Bob, he'd have had a 5-second pass on that one.
Boy, I think you're absolutely right, Ted. Watch the far lane as Dobbs just leans it over to the left, right out by the wall. Pretty close at the finish, but the time is what matters. On to our next pair. There's Tony Bogolo from Hamilton, Ohio, in Daytona, Dodge Daytona bodywork, that is. His opponent, Todd Payton, the former world champion from Ontario.
Bogolo also going with one of those mountain motors, 540 cubic inches. He chooses the traditional Keith Black block. Now, you really wonder how big can they get these funny car engines as they start to leave that 526 mark.
The advantage off the line. Great start for both cars, but Payton, the former world champion, his new blue color scheme takes the victory.
Oh, look at the ET, 6.10 for each competitor. Now, that's a drag race.
Now here is the reigning world champion, Mark Thomas, a grain farmer from Louisville, Ohio, who uses ethanol rather than methanol in his machine. Butch Kernodle damaged too many parts in the first round. He cannot answer the bell. Mark Thomas will single.
A reminder now, Mark Thomas set down Monty Todd in round number one with a 6.02. Remember, low ET gets lane choice. Thomas a little bit of bump off the pad, throws away the blower belt, and still cranks out a 6.03.
Well, that's going to be bad news for somebody in the semis. Now, here is the man everybody's been talking about since the season opener at Darlington, South Carolina, Dennis Bedrosian. He is going to run a single as well. Gary Rattell cannot make the lights. But let's go back to Darlington. About a month ago, watch the far lane.
It was against Von Smith in the final that Dennis Bedrosian forgot where the finish line was. No, not really. The parachute didn't open, the throttle hung open, and Dennis Bedrosian had the longest drag race of his life. Clear down to the end of the Darlington quarter mile, ate up the shutdown area, went off into the cow pasture.
Taking down a fence on the way. Boy, the thrill of victory turned to the agony of where am I in South Carolina awfully quickly. Nevertheless, Bedrosian is now repaired and ready to go. Gary Rattell is still in the paddock. He will not take part.
This is a very important run for Bedrosian. Remember, lane choice could determine the winner of a round. And guess who he runs next time? Mark Thomas.
Straight and true, down through the lights, Bedrosian, 6.133.
That's not good enough. Mark Thomas will get lane choice, Bob.
Indeed he will. Thomas against Bedrosian in one half of our alcohol funny car semis. Larry Dobbs will have lane choice when he meets fellow Canadian Todd Payton. A beautiful afternoon here in Steele, Alabama. Great weather for drag racing. Now it's time for a track fact. Here is Brett Kepner, the latest in racing technology.
Big Daddy Don Gerlitz has long been acknowledged as one of the great innovators in the sport of racing, sometimes using some pretty unconventional methods to determine state-of-the-art information. But this weekend at the Super Nationals, it was crew member Bruce Langson, brother of driver Richard Langson, who discovered an incredible way to determine new aerodynamic information in top fuel racing. What Bruce did was come up with this incredibly simple chalk and water mixture. Before each qualifying run, Garlitz and the crew would whitewash different areas of the race car. This chalk mixture would dry as the car was going down the track and make footprints, if you will, of the wind and its effect on the car. The darkest areas show where the chalk was blown off most, which means this is where the biggest amount of downforce was. The wash here shows a wave-like motion as the air came up over this lip of the spoiler and then was forced back down for more down pressure. Now, they found out on this front wing that by the pattern here, there was actually an amount of stall in the wing, just like an airplane, where it was not producing downforce. And this footprint actually gave them the information they need to now realize that they need more wing in the front end area. Now, they put whitewash on the side of the car and found out, amazingly, that no air is touching this part of the race car, that the front end is, just like Big Daddy's always said, punching a hole in the atmosphere as the car goes down the track. Now, the most information they gained was right up here on the rear wing. If you take a look at this footprint, it shows that underneath there is not as much lift as was thought. Therefore, this wing is doing its job. The one thing they did find out, however, was the third element of this triple element rear wing was not producing the downforce it could. Therefore, this also resulted in a change in that part of the wing. And believe me, for just the price of some chalk and some water, Garlitz and Langston have found out an awful lot here at the Super Nationals.
All right, thanks, Brett. It just goes to show you, sometimes low-tech can be high-tech. Top Fuel when we return. Welcome back to a beautiful day at Steele, Alabama. As you can see, not a cloud in the sky. A year ago, we had enormous thunderheads. Right now, we're ready for Top Fuel semifinals. Here is the McGee-entered double overhead cam V8 Top Fuel dragster driven by David Grubnik, who was a surprise entry here in the semifinals. His opponent, Jack Ostrander, Pontiac Jack.
Jack Ostrander cranked out an incredible 519 as he continues to set the pace faster and faster. Now you can bet that Grubnik will take a shot on the tree. His hole shot advantage is the only thing that's going to get him down into the finals.
Pontiac Jack giving directions to his crew as he sits in the pits. I said double overhead cam. It's actually a quad cam on that McGee Top Fueler.
And a hole shot. It works indeed. Grubnik is out on Ostrander, but he goes away at half track. The McGee let him down. It'll be Jack Ostrander picking up the victory with a 5.28, 272 miles per hour. Now, 272 does not really go with 5.28. Watch this car get up on the tire and really move as he goes through the lights.
There's Grubnik's problem in the far lane. He, too, threw the blower belt.
I know that everybody had to panic when they heard that. I would imagine it was a crossed magneto or plug wire situation.
No, when I got to the lights, they must have been unplugged when they started, when they rolled it over.
The ground wires were off.
One of the ground wires was off.
The bottom one fell off. Where's your gloves?
Didn't mean to do that.
It is still spinning the tires violently. Are you going to try and calm this thing down?
I put more wing in it.
Didn't help. You're going to need more.
Put some more. Yeah, we'll work it out.
Saw Pontiac Jack looking up the drag strip, waiting to see who his final round opponent would be. One of these men, there is Richard Langston, going up against Clayton Harris.
Langston qualified number two, so should be the favorite to beat Harris. But remember, Harris came off the trailer in round number one with a 5.20. Big Daddy Don Garland backing up his driver into those hot, sticky tracks of rubber.
Clayton Harris bringing down the visor. This car has really been running this weekend. Another unsponsored machine.
Clayton is running that famous Clayton clutch right now.
There is Big, watching his man preparing for battle. Long staging here. That's bad news for these nitro-powered machines. And a red light for Langston. Let's see what Harris can do.
Clayton Harris will stand on it through the lights. A 4.97, an unbelievable track record as Harris digs into the four-second area.
Watch the right-hand lane. There's the red light. Harris with a beautiful lead, 4.77. You can see the torque in that car bringing those front wheels up. A 4.97 track record. Clayton Harris, by a big margin, will have lane choice when he meets Jack Ostrander in the finals of Top Fuel. We'll take a quick timeout and come back with semis in Pro Stock. Welcome back to the Super Nationals by Parts Pro Performance Centers here at Alabama International Dragway. Bob Barsha, Ted Jones with you. Brett Kepner is down on the big end waiting to meet our winners. We move on to the Pro Stock semifinals. There is John Yoke from Ellenboro, West Virginia. 812 cubic inches of Ford power as opposed to the 802 Olds. Under the bonnet for this man, Doug Kirk, former world champion, unbeaten thus far in 1995.
But bear in mind that Yoke is running just as good at times as Doug Kirk is. So right now you can bet if he gets a hole shot on Kirk, Kirk could be in big trouble.
You're on board with Doug Kirk as he stages the car very carefully, comes up against the rev limiter, off he goes into second gear. Now he'll reach up and grab third gear and finally fourth gear as he goes across the finish line. But you can see John Yoke is ahead of him.
John Yoke treat him at the start by 4/100ths of a second. You don't often see that happen to the former world champ.
Actually, they had identical ET, 6.82 seconds. So John Yoke won that with sheer driving, a gate job off the starting line.
682 to 683, it slowed down. It only went 203 this time. But it wasn't even that close. You all shot Kirk to boot, and you're in your first final.
It's great. We, you know, I thought that's what we might have to do. He's been making a lot of power all weekend, so, you know, I'm tickled to death.
Now, your background is mostly in the sportsman car ranks.
Yeah, it is. You know, a lot of bracket race, quick eight stuff at best, you know.
You've applied those skills to pro tree racing real well. Unbelievable.
Thank you.
Well, the Cinderella story continues for John Yoke. Now, in the near lane, Mike Bell will go up against Robert Patrick Jr. Normally, Robert Patrick, right there at work in his office, is favorite going in, but the way Bell has been running this weekend,
this will have to be a story very similar to the last one we saw, Bob. It's going to be up to Robert Patrick to get the hole shot off the starting line to stop Bell. Bell has him covered by nearly a tenth of a second.
You see Patrick backing in. All important that the cars be properly centered.
They're ready to go, waiting on the green light. Let's see who's out first. It'll be Robert Patrick, a 4.02. Realize a 400 is a perfect light. He's out on him. He has him pulling him through the lights. Robert Patrick pulls off the upset, 6.89 to a losing 6.84.
It all happened right there at the tree by 0.02 of a second. Patrick was on the lights. Mike Bell went quicker, but at that point, it was just too late.
Let's ride along and see what it's like to go 6.89 seconds with Robert Patrick. Now into second gear, third and fourth. You see how quickly that the engine winds up between gears. Folks, he's on the shutdown. He's shutting the car down already.
And he is in the final.
Here I am talking about John Yoke's incredible launch on Doug Kirk. 82 to an 83 over there, 689 to a losing 684 for the Roy Hill team car, but I know that there's only one thing you care about, so I'll tell you.
That's
4.02 reaction time.
Well, Mike's a good driver. I come up here, I knew he was going to be hard. He's been the fastest car all weekend, and I wasn't playing any games up here. He's a good lever, and I had to be on my game up here and just do what it took. Car's got a couple more hundredths left in it, and I think we can give him a good run in the final.
Let's face it, you have never been in the 670s before, and you're up against a 677 car in the final.
Oh, man, is Robert Patrick Jr. pumped or what? Looks like he needs somebody to headbutt. He will have his hands full when he meets John Yoke in the finals of Pro Stock. Now, earlier we mentioned the interesting clutch in Clayton Harris's top fuel car. Here's Brett with the report.
You know, it's important to remember with the tremendous success of John Mitchell's Montana Express with Clayton Harris at the wheel, that a lot of this car's performance is due strictly to Alabama's finest. Remember the clutch that Big Daddy Don Garlitz attempted to utilize in IHRA competition 2 years ago that was a Clayton Harris design that used a fluid coupling device? Well, this is the latest mutation of that Clayton Harris design, this time using all pneumatic equipment. In other words, it's all air controlled, and indeed, obviously worked to perfection on a track that was tricky enough to slow other teams down. If this thing gets a grip, this is going to be a threat for the whole 95 Snap-on Tour.
Well, it should make for an interesting top fuel final, but we still have several finalists to decide. Coming up next, Pro Modified Semi. Stay with us. Time for the semifinals in Pro Modified. Here at Alabama International Dragway, there's car builder Tommy Mooney. This should be an interesting matchup with South Dakota trucking company owner Chuck Peterson.
Chuck Peterson really took advantage of the IHRA rule, which allows you a 100-pound weight break if you run a nostalgia car. Now, a 1970 Chevelle is very aerodynamic compared to the 1941 Willys of Tommy Mooney.
As you can see, Mooney in the background has lowered the roof line as much as possible to try to cheat the wind. Mooney is a car builder, so he knows the insides and out of his own machine very, very well.
And once again, it'll be the supercharged car against the nitrous injected car. In this case, Peterson with the big huffer on top. Both cars will stage very carefully. Hole shot is everything. Tommy Mooney's out first.
A slight advantage at half track, making the car length.
Tommy Mooney, 667 to pick up the win, puts Chuck Peterson on the trailer. Watch one more time now. Look at the front end up off the ground for Tommy Mooney as he put the hole shot on Peterson.
A repeat of the Winter National semifinal, but it wasn't a hole shot this time. It was a 667 to a 669 ET-wise, but you did leave on him. Now the big question. High 660s are not going to cut it if it ends up being the two wheelies in the final. What in the world can you do if Scotty wins this next round?
I don't know. We need some help from somewhere. I don't know what's wrong. We changed battery last time and thought they'd get it, but we just got a problem. Can't find it.
Can you get it back to the 657 combination?
I don't know. I'd give anything for a 50 now.
We're going to need it.
Tommy Mooney in his second straight final, 1995. Who will he meet? Either Scotty Cannon or this man, Pat Moore. Moore was in the finals against Mooney in the season-opening Winter Nationals at Darlington, South Carolina, while Scotty Cannon has some ground to make up after going out in the first round at Darlington.
That could be because Pat Moore has cat-like reflexes. Remember, he was a former world champion when Larry Nance hired him.
That in the sportsman rank. Oh, all kinds of problems for Moore.
Moore has to shut it down, and very wisely he did so. He did have a hole shot on Scotty Cannon, but listen to this. 651 for Scotty Cannon. Watch Pat Moore get out of shape now, coming off the line, almost turns and goes across the center line, tries to correct, and then very wisely lifts.
Scotty Cannon is obviously always the entertainer, but now the question remains. Since you have brutalized everybody else in this class and go into the final round with a 16 hundredths of a second advantage, is the game plan to give the world the first under 6.5 second pro mod run?
We're going to do it.
Say it again.
We're going to run it. We're going to do it.
Are you going to set it up that way?
Well, the blower's got 4 or 5 runs on it, so if it went a 51 with that many runs, it'll do it, but we ain't going to strip the blower because, well, I don't know. I ain't going to say we ain't going to do it. We'll just have to wait and see.
You are not going to put a new supercharger on it, and you're not going to repair this one?
Well, I don't know. I ain't gonna say.
Never a man to show his hand. Scotty Cannon in an all-Willies final against Tommy Mooney. Listen to Cannon's numbers. 655, 658, 651. What does he have in store next? We move on to the semifinals of Alcohol Funny Car. There is Todd Payton, former world champion. His opponent will be his fellow Canadian, Larry Dobbs, who chose the left lane.
And remember, Dobbs is running that big mountain motor, and guess what? It's working. He's flirting around with the fives. He could dive in there at any time.
Alcohol-fueled cars take a long time to stage. No big heat buildup problem in the engine. Now they are launched. Dobbs carries the wheels, but he does have the advantage off the line. Now here comes Payton.
Dobbs, a little bit of a problem through the lights. Todd Payton, a 6.04, 235 miles per hour.
Terrific side-by-side race. A 6.08 for Dobbs. Once again, that left lane, he gets right out there by the wall. Got it straightened up, but it was too late.
I'll tell you, the reaction times weren't that much different. It was a 6.04 to a 6.08, so he gave you a run for it.
It was close. Like I said, I saw him most of the way. Waited on it in high gear, and we all know this thing makes a little bit more of a charge than a lot of cars out here. I waited, punched the gear, it picked up the wheels, and away we went again.
I'll tell you, though, whoever wins the other half of this is going to give you a war.
Oh, man, this has been a tough weekend all around. It's not going to get any easier.
It ain't over. Good luck.
Thanks, man.
Now here is Dennis Bedrosian from Flemington, New Jersey. Bedrosian will have his hands full going up against the two-time world champion, Mark Thomas.
Remember, Mark Thomas cranked off that 6.07 in the most previous round. Bedrosian did not get lane choice this time, could only manage a 6.13. He's got to go for a hole shot.
He doesn't get it. Mark Thomas is out first. Thomas has him at half track and drives away.
Oh, he's on a pass. 6.02, 233 miles per hour for Mark Thomas. Well, his nightmares are over, Bob.
But he may need to step it up for the finals because in qualifying, Todd Payton came up with a 5.91 track record. This should be a great matchup in the final. Now it's time for this week's edition of Drag Review. With all the news in drag racing, here's Brett Kepner.
When Doug Kirk opened up the very first Pro Stock qualifying session here at the Parts Pro Super Nationals with a world record 6.75-second blast. He signaled the end of an era, the end of the single parachute Pro Stocker era. Keep in mind, the International Hobbit Association has never mandated double parachutes on their Pro Stockers, despite the fact that the cars are now deep into the 6-second zone at over 205 miles per hour. But Kirk was unable to stop his Oldsmobile Cutlass on that world record run. He spun the car out on the sand trap at the end of Alabama International Dragway with minimal damage. But let's face it, that alone told the IHRA tech officials that they will probably be mandating twin parachutes on Pro Stockers by the end of the 1995 season. That's this edition of Drag Review.
All right, thank you, Brett. Just in time for happy hour. Finals coming up from Alabama International. Stay with us. Welcome back to Alabama International Dragway. Bob Barsha, Ted Jones, and Brett Kepner with you, where we are just moments away from the finals here at the Super Nationals. But right now it's time for Big Daddy Don Garland with this edition of Inside Scoop.
Today I'm going to give you a crash course in fuel and clutch management systems. We have 10 solenoids controlled by 10 timers. This will regulate our fuel from 47 gallons a minute, what we need when we leave the starting line, to 60 gallons a minute, what the engine demands in the middle of the race course, and then to 55 to 56 gallons when it goes into the timing traps. If you can get it just like that, you got a winner. The clutch, well, we got three solenoids that control the air release out of the cannon. That's controlled by three timers. That gives you that power to hold that throwout bearing so the clutch doesn't engage and spin the tires. And then I have my little auxiliary system that I won't talk too much about that I use in an emergency. That's my crash course for today. I'm Big Daddy Don Garland, and that's my inside scoop for today.
All right, thank you, Big. We move on now to the finals in Top Fuel. There is Jack Ostrander from Waterford, Michigan. His opponent, Clayton Harris, who, remember, in the previous round, put up that 4.97-second pass. And you know, coming into this event, I would have had to have favored Jack Ostrander because he hasn't stopped racing. He's been running the IHRA trail all of these years. Clayton dropped out. He's back in the game, but boy, is he back in the game. It's like the old New Dimension Dragster days. With headers blazing, they're off. Problems in the far lane for Jack Ostrander. Clayton Harris takes it. Clayton Harris with a 5.16, 259, the speed off just a little bit. We'll look one more time as they come off the line. You'll notice Clayton Harris burning a valve. They're titanium valves, and he's burning a valve, but it doesn't slow the car down one bit.
Through the 1960s and early 1970s, Clayton Harris became a household name in the sport. At one point, the quickest man on the face of the planet in a Top Fuel dragster and Big Daddy Don Garlitz's arch rival. I don't think any victory in at least the last 20, though, has been as sweet as this one.
That's the very truth there, Brett. I guarantee you this is wonderful. The Lord's good to me. This IHRA is good to me. The people's good to me. And I'm proud to be back in Alabama, and to win our first race in Alabama is just overwhelming.
We move on now to the Pro Stock Final. You are on board with Robert Patrick Jr. in his Mountain Motor Ford Mustang. There is his opponent. Everyone is still talking about young John Yoke from Ellenboro, West Virginia, in his 812 cubic inch Ford Thunderbird.
You know, the word in the Pro Stock pits is that John Yoke has the second best Ford engine that John Causey has ever built. And the best Ford engine, well, they claim it's in Sox and Martin's car.
Well, Ronnie Sox did not make the field, but only narrowly. Right now, Yoke has other problems as Patrick drives away from him.
Yoke slows down to a 7.04, Patrick a 6.81 to pick up a solid victory. Let's go through it with Robert Patrick. As you see him going through the gears, look how quick that 810 cubic inch Ford winds tight.
I don't think there's a racer on the planet who likes to lose to one of his old race cars. Robert Patrick knew he had to hit this one on, and it did, 6.81.
Woo!
I don't want to spoil it. The new guy left on you by 200s, but he got loose in the mid-range.
All I want to know is one thing. Have you driven a Ford lately?
Seems like everybody's driving them this weekend. Robert, congratulations. We move on to the Pro Modified Final. Number one qualifier against number two. Scotty Cannon right there is number one.
Well, this is the way the ladder is designed. Number one against number two in the finals to give you the best race of the day. Scotty Cannon, the supercharged 526 cubic inch Chevrolet powered 1940 Willys against Tommy Mooney's 706 cubic inch Pontiac. Great lead. Give it to Mooney off the line, but he has big mechanical problems. Sparks everywhere. Cannon will win. Scotty Cannon cranking off those 650, 652, 213. Look at the replay. As you see Mooney coming off the pad, something breaks on the car.
Hey, this is the one you needed. I mean, from a point standpoint, you needed to come back this
hard. I told my boys, I said, you know what would be a dream? I said, we need to go down and set both ends of the record. That'd be like going another round at Darlington. I said, and then we might win. He says, well, we done it.
That's all you needed. The Scotty story continues.
Congratulations to Scotty Cannon. All that remains is our alcohol funny car final. Number one against number three. There is Todd Payton. That machine of his sounds a little sick, Ted.
Yes, it does. And also, it sounds like maybe he has a throttle stuck on that car. The crew is going to run out, and we'll see what happens. Meanwhile, he'll be going up against Mark Thomas, the defending world champion.
And there's the bad news for the former world champion. Todd Payton has to be pushed away. It'll be a single to the championship for Mark Thomas.
Watch out now. Thomas could uncork something at any time. He's run a 602, 602, 607. Mark Thomas is on a run straight and true. 598, 234 miles per hour. What a way to win it. He didn't act like it was a single, Bob.
Makes you wonder what we might have seen if Payton hadn't broken.
Take your helmet off. There you go. Let you breathe a little bit. And then you can hear about the 598 at 234.
Yeah, good deal. Good deal, you know. It's one of those things that, man, I heard his car pop when he went to do the burnout. I thought, okay, cool. No, I don't never like that to happen. But I'll take him, right? I mean, we like it a lot.
And rightly so, Mark. We'll be back to wrap things up from Alabama. It's after two rounds of the 95 season, Ted.
Well, as you can see, Rhonda Hartman's still on top. But Rhonda, watch out for Clayton Harris. That number five guy will get you. Meanwhile, in Pro Stock Eliminator, Doug Kirk on top. Robert Patrick moves into second place with his victory here today. In Pro Modified, Scotty Cannon makes a big move into second place. And finally, in Alcohol Funny Car, Mark Thomas on top where we're used to seeing him.
This has been the Super Nationals by Parts Pro Performance Centers on the Snap-on Tools International Hot Rod Association Trail. Our next stop will be Buds Creek, Maryland for both professional and sportsman racing. We hope you'll join us for that. I'm Bob Barsha for Ted Jones and Brett Kepner. Thanks for being with us. So long for now from Steele, Alabama.